together as the people of God. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer.
Amen.
One more thing. There is many bulletins out. Everything's up on the TVs for you to follow along with. If you want to look like there, then great. God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who is full of compassion, fountain of living water.
Pour out our mercy over us. Our sins are mine, O Lord,
and we long to be free.
Rebuild the world of ruin,
and amen.
We have torn.
Wash
us in our cleansing fire.
Make us alive in the Spirit, following in the way of Jesus.
Keep going.
Beloved, God's word never fails. His promise rests on grace by the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power of God. Your sins are forgiven, and God remembers them no more. Journey in the way of Jesus.
Amen.
We'll have a first Advent song, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
Christ and love of God in the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Peace let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and all who walk our here to worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Please join me in prayer today. Let us pray. Holy God,
Heavenly Father,
in the waters of the flood you saved the chosen,
and in the wilderness of temptation
you protected your Son from sin. Renew us
in the gift of baptism.
May your holy angels be with us, that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Through Jesus Christ,
our Savior and Lord,
who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. First reading is from Genesis chapters 9, verses 8 through 17. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you. And with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal on earth with you, as many as came out of the ark, I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you, for all future generations. I have set my vow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the vow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the vow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on earth." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll now read responsibly Psalms chapter 29, verses 1 through 10. "To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous.
Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
Lead me into your truth and teach me, for you are God of my salvation. In you I have trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love, and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore you teach sinners in your way.
You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way.
All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies."
Our second reading today is going to be from Peter, chapter 3, verses 18 through 22. "Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he also lived and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven, and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and the power remains subject to him." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Spirit that comes upon Jesus at his baptism In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was the wild beast, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent, and believe in the good news, the gospel of the Lord."
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
Sermon because he always sends it to me, and so that I can print it in the bulletins that I take to the shut-ins. Let us pray. Father, grant that we say with our lips, we may believe in our hearts. And what we believe in our hearts, we may show forth in our lives. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to read to you a real ad that ran in a newspaper a while back. Animal nut needed to live in with casually abnormal family, consisting of 23 dogs, 9 goats, 7 cats, 9 mallards, 3 horses, and assorted transient critters. Duties consist of feeding, combing, petting, cleaning up after, and loving same. Occasional sergeanting of 2 boys, 9 and 14 years old. Benefits consist of room and board, use of car, dining out often, small salary, and access to family psychiatrist. No experience required. Your pet, okay. Age, gender identification, unimportant. I read that unusual ad and I thought of poor Noah, cooped up with all those animals on the ark. One cynic has said that Noah isn't deserving of our pity. He should have swatted the 2 gnats, 2 flies, and the 2 mosquitoes when he had a chance. A list once circulated on the internet dubbed, "Everything I Need to Know I Learned from Noah and the Ark." Among the items on the list are, plan ahead. It wasn't raining when Noah built the ark. Stay fit. When you're 600 years old, someone might ask you to build something really big. Don't listen to critics. Do what has to be done. Speed isn't always an advantage. The cheetahs were on board, so were the snails. Remember that the Ark was built by amateurs and the Titanic was built by professionals. Remember that the woodpeckers inside are often a bigger threat than the storm outside. And last but not least, no matter how bleak it looks, there's always a rainbow on the other side. Thank God for rainbows. Here are some insightful thoughts, all of which were spoken by children under 10. Some of you can relate. One kid says, "You can listen to thunder after lightning to tell how close you are. You come to getting hit. If you don't hear it, never mind." Another says, "I'm not sure how clouds get formed, but the clouds know how to do it, and that is the important thing." And a third person says, "Rainbows are just to look at, not really to understand." Well, that youngster is half right. Rainbows are not really to understand, rather they are to remind us of the grace and mercy and love of God. Rainbows remind us that God has made a covenant with his people. Years ago, in the Muppet movie, Kermit the Frog sang a song in which he asked, "Why are there so many songs about rainbows?" And you and I know, don't we? The Bible tells us that Noah witnessed this rainbow after a great flood destroyed all known life, except that which was preserved on a wooden ship called an ark. And God made a promise to Noah that never again would a flood destroy the earth. God said, "This is the sign of the covenant which I am making between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all successive generations. I set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a sign of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come about, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud, and I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature and all flesh, of all flesh. And never mind, never again shall the water become a flood to destroy all flesh." Thank God for rainbows. They are a reminder of our relationship with God. Why are there so many songs about rainbows? First of all, because rainbows often follow storms. Noah's family had experienced a flood of incredible magnitude. But now the rains were over, the waters were receding, and a rainbow appeared in the heavens. Don't you imagine their hearts leap to see that rainbow? There are people who know the relief of seeing a rainbow. Hurricanes are devastating, but at least they're over with quickly. Floods can sit around and do damage for months. No wonder when trouble comes, we say, "The problems come flooding in on me." Or when it rains, it pours. Have you ever been hit by a flood of problems? In 1982, the 1982 issue of Encyclopedia Britannica yearbook carries an incredible true story of Brian Heiss and one incredible bad day in his life. Here's how it started. When Brian woke up, he found a leak in his apartment ceiling, and he ran to get a water vacuum to clean up the mess. He discovered that his car had four flat tires. He ran back inside to call someone and was knocked backward by electrical shock from the phone. He went back downstairs only to discover that his car had been stolen. Brian's car was recovered later that day. That evening, as Brian headed to his ROTC graduation ceremony, he accidentally sat on his bayonet and required immediate surgery for his injury. While he was at the hospital, part of the roof fell in at home and killed his pet canaries. As he ran across the room to check on his canaries, he slipped and injured his back, necessitating another trip to the hospital. A news reporter who had caught wind of Brian's story asked him to explain how much could happen to one person in one day. Brian replied, "It looks like God was trying to kill me, but he kept missing." God wasn't trying to kill Brian, but you can see why he felt that way. Sometimes you and I may feel like God is trying to kill us. "How much more can I stand?" we cry out. "Why me?" Storms come, waters rise, but then the rains let up, the water recedes, and a rainbow appears. And we say, "Thank God for the rainbow." Why are there so many songs about rainbows? First of all, because rainbows follow storms. Second, rainbows by their very nature symbolize hope. Whose spirit is not lifted by the sight of a bow in the clouds? Maybe it's because rainbows are so colorful. After the gray clouds and the depressing lack of sunlight and the dreary rain, to see the colors of the rainbow arrayed against the sky produces within us a strange feeling of elation. The world's still here. The sun is shining again. All's well in God's world. Don't you think Noah's family had its doubts? Sure, they had faith in God. They wouldn't have spent all that time building the ark if they did not have the faith. But still, when it has rained for 40 days and 40 nights, when you've seen your home swept away by the floodwaters, when all around you is dark and dismal, it's easy for doubt to creep in. It's easy to give in to despair. But then there comes the rainbow. The rainbow, by its very nature, is a symbol of hope. Why do we live in a world of such incredible beauty? There are many people in the world who believe there is no rhyme and reason for life. They believe life simply began with a big bang and gradually evolved by natural selection and chance into this intricate living universe we have today. And they can be quite convincing until we come to this question. Why, in heaven's name, is it all so beautiful? Why are our eyes and our brain so constructed that we can be elated by the beauty of the rainbow? That is not a trait we need for survival. Why is it all so wonderful? At such times, the author of the book of Genesis wrote, God looked upon all he had made, and behold, it is very good. Bruce Babbitt, United States Secretary of the Interior, was addressing the question, why save endangered species, before a large conference? He recalled the words of a group of children who were asked to address the same question. One child, Gabriel, answered, because God gave us the animals. Travis and Gina wrote, because we love them. A third answered, because we'll be lonely without them. Another wrote, because they're part of our life. If we didn't have them, it would not be a complete world. The Lord put them on the earth to be enjoyed, not destroyed. Now in my lifetime, said Babbitt, I've heard many, many political, agricultural, scientific, medical, and ecological reasons for saving endangered species. I have, in fact, hired biologists and ecologists for just that purpose. All the reasons have to do with providing humans with potential cures for disease, or yielding humans new strains of drought-resistant crops, or offering humans bioremediation of oil spills, or thousands of other justifications of why species are useful to humans. But none of their reasons move me like the children's. Rainbows give us hope. They speak of meaningfulness in creation. As the little fellow said, rainbows are just to look at, not really to understand. Rainbows follow floods. They speak of hope. But most of all, rainbows remind us of our covenant relationship with God. God has made a pact with us, an unbreakable contract, if you will. That covenant was sealed in the life and person of Jesus Christ. The writer of 1 Peter puts it this way. For Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, in order that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit, in which he also went and made proclamation to the spirits now in prison, who once were disobedient when the patience of God kept waiting in the days of Noah, during the construction of the ark, in which a few, that is eight persons, were brought safely through the water. And corresponding to that, baptism now saves you. Not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for good conscience. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is at the right hand of God, having gone into heaven, after angels and authorities and powers have been subjected to him, the waters of baptism are a reminder of the waters that engulfed the earth in the time of Noah. Baptism, like the rainbow, is our reminder that we are part of the covenant relationship with the Creator of heaven and earth. Even when the waters of life flood around us, we will never be forgotten. Kermit the Frog sang, "Why are there so many songs about rainbows? Rainbows follow floods. Rainbows speak of love, of hope. Rainbows are a reminder of our covenant relationship with God." Back a few years ago, a man claiming to have a bomb burst into a station in New Zealand and made them play the Muppet song, The Rainbow Connection, for 12 straight hours. Can't be okay with that. That's a little obsessive, perhaps, but who among us is not elated to see a bow in the clouds? There's a Gaelic blessing of friendship that goes like this. May there always be work for your hands to do. May your purse always hold a corner or two. May the sun always shine warm on your window pane. May a rainbow be certain to follow each rain. May the hand of a friend always be near you. And may God fill your heart with gladness to cheer you. And as long as we have rainbows, our lives will be cheered. Amen. Let us stand for our hymn of the day, I Want Jesus to Walk with Me.
Sherry, Rob, Susan, Amelia, and Jay.
mercy is great.
In the covenant of baptism, reclaim us as beloved children. Nurture us in our baptismal identity and teach us to live within it for the sake of others. Strengthen this congregation's ministries of care and concern. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
In baptism, you join us to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We praise you for all those who have died trusting in your faithfulness. Bring us with them to the fulfillment of your reign. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Gathered in to one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God blesses us and sends us in mission to the world. You are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, free to serve your neighbor. God bless you, and that you may be a blessing in the name of the holy and life-giving Trinity.
Amen.
Our singing song is Glorious Day.
Thank you. Thanks be to God.